Welcome to Yesterday, Today, Tomorrow. My name is Mariana Cordier, and I am your host, and I am coming to you from my home via Zoom. Reopening of schools has become a serious issue across the country. Many school systems are trying to balance the needs of parents, students, teachers, and administrators with the risk of exposure to COVID. Today, education is more than just learning. It has evolved to provide students from K through 12 many services, such as social interaction, emotional growth, counseling, meals, and daycare services for parents that must work out of the home. Across the country, schools that reopened have had mixed success, some with outbreaks affecting children and teachers, and others with no issues so far. The question of how to reopen schools has become a complex equation with several variables needing consideration in the process of developing solutions. Recently, private schools challenged Montgomery County Health Department's decision to keep private schools physically closed. Outcry from the parents and schools raised several issues regarding the ramification on children and families if not permitted to reopen. Today, I have three wonderful guests who are going to discuss these issues and concerns with us. My first guest is Elizabeth Gillette, a parent with a child attending private schools in Montgomery County. My next guest is Ebony Terrell Shockley. She has a Ph.D. and is the Executive Director of Teacher Education at the University of Maryland College Park. And our third guest is Yin Ting Huang. She has a Ph.D. and is the Associate Professor with the Department of Hearing and Speech Services at the University of Maryland College Park. Welcome, ladies. Thank you so much for joining us. And I'd like to start with Elizabeth. Let me ask you, the issue that came up in Montgomery County was that public schools are going to be doing distance learning. And the private schools are going to, had plans and had tried to design a way to reopen, taking into consideration the CDC guidelines and such. But it turned into a bit of a fiasco. What happened?
Well, what happened was Montgomery County came out with a blanket closure for public schools through the first semester. In the midst of that, the private schools were developing plans, as you said, to accommodate CDC guidelines, Department of Health guidelines, and to determine whether it was feasible to bring private school children back safely. In the midst of preparing those plans and actually presenting them to the various governing bodies of the private schools, Montgomery County's health director provided a blanket order, executive order, saying no schools, private schools, could open until after October 1st.
So since he issued that first order, I know he then, the governor issued an order that said you couldn't do that, then the executive office came out with another order, and then he rescinded that order and said, you know, they'll evaluate, I guess, you know, school by school proposal for reopening. And so now the schools, if they choose to and meet the criteria, can reopen. So what's the parents' dilemma in this? What are the arguments on both sides of a parent wondering, should I or shouldn't I send this child to school?
And that's a great question because I am one of those parents.
Yeah, that's why you're on. And,
you know, obviously the first and foremost concern is the safety of my child. That includes, you know, limiting exposure to any you know, situation that would include the virus. But I think the safety of the child also needs to be considered as far as the social impact, the social interaction, the psychological impact of not attending school versus distance learning. And I think it goes, I do believe that there are, you know, valid arguments on both sides of that. We all know that children need social interaction. How they get that social interaction has typically been through school or some sort of education program. That's the traditional way of doing these things. We went through the distance learning in the spring with our private school, and it went very well. And I don't have any complaints about the ability of the schools to put together a distance learning. What I did notice is the social impact on my child as far as having to see people through a screen all the time. it became that our saying in our home was, I am zoomed out.
Well, and I can sympathize with that because I've been zoomed out myself as an adult. So I can imagine. Professor Hong, you know, you have experience with children and the development. You know, what kind of impact does this have on our kids being, virtual learning? They talk about don't have too much screen time, you know, when they're home, and now everything is screen time. I mean, so, you know, and the need for socialization, and not just that, but the emotional, what is your view on this?
Yeah, thank you so much for this question. And I really liked the way that you guys both prefaced this kind of policy question that we're grappling with, because in fact, there are so many players, and in fact, oftentimes the same player is wearing multiple hats. So, you know, Beth is both, a parent as well as, you know, thinking about all these policy issues. I'm a scientist and I'm also a parent thinking about what distance learning for a second grader is gonna be like in the fall. I think on the science side, I feel like the challenge has been that our evolving knowledge of COVID is changing. And in fact, like a lot of the science that we have about screen time wasn't really crafted in a period in time to tackle questions about global pandemics. So we have questions about, how much iPad time should a kid get and how is that related to learning? But in fact, the findings are not really kind of well suited for tackling a situation in which all of us are on screens all of the time. And so I think that what little that we have suggests a pretty nuanced take on these issues. So on the one hand, the really early stuff, you know, the stuff that came out in the 90s when like kind of screen time, screens were fairly new, suggested that kids were not learning as much, probably because, you know, screens were pretty novel technology. Whereas the more recent stuff suggests that kids are actually able to learn a fair bit as long as the interactions are fairly contingent, like these kind of back and forth interactions. And so that, I think that mirrors some of Beth's experiences with distance learning in the spring. On the other hand, there's a whole literature about Zoom fatigue, both for adults as well as for kids. Interacting over screens is just different, right? So like a lot of our interactions in live, in-person interactions involve following people's eye movements to different places, but that's fairly meaningless in the kind of a Zoom context. It's also the case that there's a whole variety of children who and families who have different access to technology.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, the one thing that occurred to me as well was not just access to technology, but language, you know, and education. I have clients who have a third grade education and don't speak English. I have other clients who speak multiple languages and have all the access in the world, but don't have the time. They can't be there to help their child through the process or make sure that they are actually participating and attending the virtual mm-hmm. learning. And so, you know, that kind of brings into the conversation the daycare portion of this that I think hasn't been given the weight that it needs. I think daycare is one of those things that people, you need daycare, but it's more now than just, you know, for little children, it's for also your older children, right?
Yeah, I think that's definitely right. I think that, in many ways, like science can tell us, it can answer questions like who is, how much additional childcare are parents taking on? Who in the household is taking on more childcare? But science is not great at deciding these questions, these blanketed, policy kinds of statements, for the reasons that you mentioned, which is that families are quite different, you know, in the degrees right. to which they have support, what pre-COVID times are like for families vastly differs, hence during COVID, people are managing in different ways.
So Ebony, we're not leaving you out of this conversation. Thank you for joining us and your patience, but you know, you have experience in the teacher education world. And so from a teacher's perspective, my question to you is, What are some of the challenges you see for them now? And, you know, this isn't a conversation that I think is going to be over or done with this semester, next semester. You know, I think this is something we're looking at for like at least the next 18 months. So what do you think?
Sure. Thank you for your question. And I really appreciate the Zoom fatigue and the components that also foreshadowed earlier. For teachers, there are a number of challenges. One of the challenges is the right to return or not, right? So that's one of the challenges that teachers face. In some states and in some systems, teachers have the option to work from home and continue with using their distance learning playbook for all kinds of enrichment activities. And then in other spaces, teachers are not afforded that opportunity. And so that's one of the challenges, depending on whether teachers feel up to returning and if they have pre-existing conditions and whether they have the right to refuse to go into work. Another challenge for teachers is attendance of students. There are a range of issues affecting our nation's children that prevent them from attending school in person or virtual. And so certainly in this virtual space, how one accounts for attendance is another challenge. In addition to these challenges, teachers are also wanting to make sure that they offer the one-to-one and the small group interaction that we know is critical, especially in the early grades. And so right. Those are some of the challenges that teachers are facing virtually. A challenge that a teacher would face in a face-to-face option would be if, you know, a school did not phase in some of the opportunities and the learning experiences for the students. And so, you know, rushing back can also present challenges because even though the school thinks they're ready, you're not really ready until you're ready. And what I mean by that is you can think through everything, but we're dealing with human beings and not robots. And the ways that our learners react to these new, you know, newly outfitted spaces, for example, we don't really.
Well, you know, I have had in my office multiple times where my computer person is fixing my database or something and saying, oh, it's not the software, it's user error. So I can see where in the schools they might find difficulty, especially with the younger kids. And it's funny because I would space it this way. I would say the older kids and the younger kids. The middle kids, I think, will be all right. But convincing a kindergartner or a first grader they got to keep the mask on all the time, or a high schooler who doesn't believe they have to follow the rules, it can be challenging.
Sure. And that's a challenge for the teacher who's in person as well. You know, can a six-year-old really sit down for that long and with the mask on? You know, preparing teachers on, you know, making sure early learners understand routines is no easy feat. But imagine those routines with the mask and 6 feet apart. And so there are a myriad of challenges. And certainly teachers will always, you know, fight the good fight. We love children. This is our commitment. We are called to this work. I just hope we also consider, you know, the teachers in this equation as well. It's critical.
So Beth, as a parent and facing all these challenges and decisions and not knowing necessarily what's the best decision at the moment, with hearing what they, Professor Hong and Ebony have been talking about, what does that leave with you? Because ultimately parents really are the ones making this decision. I mean, what does this leave you thinking?
I really appreciate both of their perspectives, coming from policy standpoint as well from a teacher standpoint, and ye having a second grader as well. For me, you know, I'm also a product of a public school education and the product of two public school teachers. So the back and forth that I'm having with that is, and what I've heard here is, I believe Ebony is absolutely correct. I heard a wonderful plan from my school today about the classroom size and the positioning of the desks and the mask and the bathroom breaks and the recess and the gym class. But as Ebony said and was pointed out, you don't know until you know. And that means you have to go to find out. So that does concern me a little, because one of the the first thing I'm thinking is, what happens when that first child becomes sick or that first teacher become sick? And just as something for you and Ebony to think about too, the proposal for my particular school, regardless of whether it's virtual or in-person learning, teachers are going to be expected to be in the classroom. So they will have to leave their homes. So that's another situation where even the teachers, you know, are going to be put in a position that we need to think about, as well as, is that good for our children? Is that good for them? Is there going to be a more psychological impact? It's negative by worrying as you're sitting there trying to learn or try to teach.
Well, you know, one of the things that I noticed, and hate to single them out because I'm sure that everything they tried was in good faith, are the schools in Georgia where, you know, the high school was packed, no masks, no distancing, and now they have some multiple teachers and students testing positive for COVID, and so folks have to quarantine. None of us want that, but the reality that at any moment that could happen in any district, in any school, really raises the issue, I think, of our future. Is this an opportunity for us to completely change the way we view education and how we, you know, not only develop how it's going to be given to our children, but maybe we can be more creative and satisfy more than just the learning issue, since frankly that there's more that schools are doing than just learning. What do you think, Ebony?
Absolutely. I mean, you know, education is not meant to be stuck in the past anyway. It is designed specifically to, you know, have a futuristic aim. And I really believe that this is an opportunity for innovation and creativity. And thinking about, as Beth mentioned, you know, the whole child, and I think Professor Wong mentioned this too, schools are, you know, not just places for education, they are places, you know, for social exercises, physical exercises, but what can we do to, in a virtual space, that could mirror that? Because in person doesn't always mean better. So what can we do with our mobile devices? You know, what there's a lot of, you know, learning that can happen with cell phones, which many households have, thinking about it from an equity perspective and an accessibility perspective. And I think we are absolutely in a time where, you know, we can collectively figure out what to do next to bring in those pieces that we feel are missing because we are used to our traditions.
Well, I think that's perfect. That's what you said is really on point. And I think this country has been always historically on the edge of innovation and the sciences and coming up with new perspectives and doing things providing services. I almost want to look at education as a service. And I think that we have to address the component of daycare for parents, because how can a parent peacefully go to work knowing that their child is taken care of and safe, and that it's a holistic approach? This child doesn't just need to know how to add, multiply, subtract, you know, it needs to be able to speak, it needs to be able to relate with others, and it has a whole slew of things. So Professor Huang, what do you think? Do you have any ideas, some innovative ideas?
Yeah, no, I want to echo Ebony's point that this is a period of it's a period of great challenge, no doubt, but also a period of opportunity. And I think the other point that I come from a department of hearing and speech sciences, and so we train speech language pathologists to work in the school system. And so I know, talking to my colleagues this past spring, that all of a sudden all the in-person services were moved to remote Zoom formats. And so I think that it's opened up a whole avenue of ways in which we can reach and access and provide services to many people who otherwise would not be able to get these services. But of course, there are these inherent challenges to moving to new platforms. And so I think that, and also to raise, to address your point directly about childcare, I think that, I mean, COVID-19 is such an interesting time because in some ways, like, you know, many privileged parents are now feeling just a hint of some of the challenges that many parents in diverse Montgomery County has felt for a long time. And so I think that when we think about innovation, I think that we, and kind of, you know, ways in which we can bring everyone forward, I think that this is a time in which we can, you know, look seriously at some of the issues, some of the gaps that have been created by way of COVID-19, gaps that we have been measuring for a while in science, and yet we haven't quite had the motivation or data, in fact, to kind of move on some of the policy issues.
So, Ebony, I was thinking about this and thinking, you know, teachers are a wonderful resource for figuring out how they can better reach the kids, whether it's in person, whether it's virtual, or maybe there's another approach that no one has really given much thought to or has not come up with yet, that, some creative parents came up with pods, and others are thinking of different things. But, you know, from the teacher's perspective, as far as you've heard, have you heard anything, or do you have any ideas that you think might be helpful for this conversation in the future? Because we got to think about the spring semester and next year.
Sure. First, I want to address the pods was mentioned previously, and how higher education is actually wanting to close the opportunity gap with pods by offering tutoring for families that maybe are not able to afford some of the financial components that are happening with many of the pods. But to your other question, in terms of resources, there are simulations that are occurring so that students at every age can participate and have some of the individualized instruction that they may miss. There are also vertical mentoring where elementary and middle or middle and high are pairing so that they have that vertical piece. And it's also their peers, so it's another student. We know that listening to adults is not always something that children want to do, especially at home. Right. And so bringing in, you know, the older kids, if you will, almost like a big brother, big sister.
Sure.
Option is certainly considered. And then the specific professional associations provide resources for families: National Science Teachers Association, the National Council of Teachers of Mathematics. Every discipline has a professional association that is offering resources for families who want to either extend and elaborate upon what their schools are offering or who want to substitute what the schools are offering. And so that is what we are preparing this next generation of teachers who are learning how to be teachers in a virtual space.
Well, that's what's amazing about our younger professionals that are coming in and having this experience for the future will really be, I think, great. One of the other things I wanted to mention was I saw that the State of Maryland website had put up a, I guess there's a group forming with stakeholders and all kinds of folks of how to perhaps utilize the public schools that are closed to kind of create this daycare or, you know, possible way of connecting students with teachers to help them through the process, but it's not school, so it'd be smaller and easier to control. What is your thought on that, Beth?
Actually, I think that that's a great idea. In fact, as you were speaking, I'm sitting here thinking about all the empty spaces that are in retail areas and places like that, that are sitting there with not being used at all, and thinking, wouldn't that be a great place to try to start with some of these ideas to make even smaller classes, pods, if you will, I guess that's the new thing, but and use those spaces to accommodate just that. I was sort of looking at that also in the terms of, you know, a lot of the homeschooling programs that I've seen, and wondering if that's also, you know, a possibility to have a technical location for the homeschooling as opposed to it truly being homeschooling in the house. So I think that's a wonderful idea, and I think there's a lot of possibilities if, as Yi and Ebony said, we think of these other ways and non-traditional school building has to be where you learn. And that was one of my questions. I was actually wondering what Ebony thought about the homeschooling process, and, you know, are you teaching, well, educating people to become teachers for that process as well?
Go ahead, Ebony. What do you think about that?
Absolutely. I think that, you know, homeschooling is certainly an option. Parents know their children, you know, well, and homeschooling, especially when there are multiple generations in a household, obviously helps with the social piece, Beth, that you started us out with. and you know, getting to know your community, because something that homeschooling can offer and virtual schooling is considering is that physical piece that we've missed from sitting in chairs.
Exactly.
And zoomed out. And so, you know, coming up with ways to for multi-sensory learning that engages the physical component, that domain is also something that we want to do.
Ebony, we're slowly running out of time. I'm sorry to all of you, but I wanted to ask you, University of Maryland College Park has where it's connecting student teachers with students who have need. If there's a parent who wants to get more information about that, where would they go?
Oh, absolutely. So they can email eterrell@umd.edu, which is me.
Oh no, are you sure you want to do that? Do it again slowly.
We have a process in place. Our Career Center at the University of Maryland also, that's the group that we're working with to pair students, and of course in education, but also in many disciplines, with parents seeking tutors.
Okay, so give the email slowly one more time so the audience can get it.
Sure. So they can email me. I know it's going to be a lot. It's fine. eterrell@umd.edu. And I will connect you to our Career Center.
That's awesome. I think that's great. University of Maryland is doing that and teaming up the student teachers with the students. That's a great experience for them, for everyone. And so that's wonderful. But unfortunately, ladies, we have run out of time. I really want to thank you for joining me today. Please join me next week at the same time or watch the show on our YouTube channel. Now, to find us, it's Yesterday, Today, Tomorrow Show. So don't forget. And if you like us, subscribe, tag, share. I'm Mariana Cordier. Until next time.